In this section, I will look at configuring network authentication. Authentication is the process of either allowing or denying a user access to the network. This section is more theory-based than the other sections, as it provides the foundation for a lot of other topics to come. In this video, I will first look at network authentication, which means looking at NTLM and Kerberos authentication protocols. Both these protocols are commonly used in networks to authenticate users against a domain controller. Next, I will look at remote authentication. These include PAP, CHAP, EAP, and PEEP. In certain areas of networking, for example, creating VPN tunnels, you may see both sets of protocols listed in the same section. The important thing to consider is what each protocol is capable of doing, and that will give you an indication of how it is being used. Lastly, I will look at how to use group policy to configure your domain to use a particular type of authentication. NTLM authentication, or NTLAN Manager, was the authentication system introduced in Windows NT. It is the successor to the Windows 95 LAN Manager, otherwise known as LM. NTLM uses a challenge response algorithm. A challenge response algorithm works by submitting the client a challenge. It is basically the same as saying, if you are who you say you are, you should be able to answer this question. Because of this, no password is sent over the network. The password is used to generate the response, and thus the server is able to validate the user without the password being transferred over the network. The problem with NTLM is that the user needs to be authenticated each time access is required. This puts more load on your domain controllers. NTLM exists in two different versions. The first is NTLM version 1 and was introduced in Windows NT. By today's standards, NTLM version 1 is considered not to be very secure. For these reasons, you should use the second algorithm, NTLM version 2. This was first introduced in Windows NT with Service Pack 4. It is also available for older clients by installing Active Directory client extensions. So nowadays, there is no reason to use NTLM version 1 or even the older LAN manager. The Kerberos authentication system provides an alternative to the NTLM authentication system and addresses some of its shortfalls. The system itself is named after the three-headed dog from Greek mythology that guards Hades. Kerberos uses a ticket-based approach. When a client computer requests access to a server or service on the network, the user must be authenticated. To ensure security on the network, the process to authenticate a user should be heavily encrypted and complex enough so that it cannot easily be broken. The problem with this approach is, when you have a lot of servers on the network or services, having a complex authentication system uses up a lot of resources. To make Kerberos more efficient, a ticket is issued to the client. Like a regular ticket, for example, concert ticket, there are certain security mechanisms built in to make sure it is authentic. Near my home is a club that has Texas Hold'em. One of the staff was telling me that to get into the monthly game, you needed to have a ticket which could be obtained by winning one of their regular games. One unscrupulous person decided to print their own tickets, and a number of these fake tickets were floating around. The staff member was telling me, without even looking at the ticket, he could tell it was a fake, just from the feel of the paper alone. Closer inspection of the ticket revealed that the colors were slightly wrong, and the small differences in the font used. Just like a regular ticket, a Kerberos ticket can easily be identified as a real ticket, and is very hard to forge. Once a ticket is obtained, the client can use this ticket to gain access to other resources on the network without having to be authenticated again. This makes Kerberos very fast. Kerberos is time-based, and tickets do expire after a certain amount of time. To use Kerberos effectively means all the time clocks on your servers have to be accurate. When you set up a domain, one of the domain controllers will generally have its internal clock synchronized to an external time source, and the other servers and clients will sync their time from a domain controller. When possible, you should use Kerberos, However, it cannot be used when the client is authenticated from an IP address. This is because Kerberos requires a trust relationship between the client and the domain. When authenticating using an IP address, the trust relationship cannot be verified. Also, Kerberos cannot be used when the client is not in the domain. In order to use Kerberos, certain information must exist on the client, which is created when the computer joins the domain. Kerberos will also not work when clients are in a different forest or using an NTLM-based trust. In order to use Kerberos in a forest, it requires a trust relationship that is either automatically or manually created. If this trust relationship is not present, Kerberos cannot be used as an authentication method. Kerberos can also be blocked by a firewall. NTLM and Kerberos are primarily used for authentication of a user on a network when they are directly connected. When connected remotely, there are often a different set of protocols used. The first of these is PAP. PAP, or Password Authentication Protocol, uses clear text. This makes the protocol very insecure and should only be used for backward compatibility or in a testing environment. Whenever possible, you should avoid using PAP. CHAP, or Challenge Handshake Authentication Protocol, is primarily used for remote authentication. There are three different versions of the protocol. The first is simply CHAP, which is used for non-Windows environments such as Unix. The next is Microsoft's version of CHAP, called MSCHAP. MSCHAP is primarily used for dial-up and remote access services such as VPN. The protocol exists in two different versions. Version 1 is easy to hack, and because of this is no longer enabled by default in Windows Vista, Windows 7, or Windows Server 2008. To address some of the security concerns, MSCHAP version 2 was developed and was first introduced in Windows 2000. If you are running Windows 95 or Windows 98, MSCHAP version 2 can be added to the operating system. There is no reason nowadays that you need to be using MSCHAP version 1. EAP, or Extensible Authentication Protocol, is not an authentication mechanism by itself, but an authentication framework. There are currently about 40 different protocols that bolt on to EAP. Since EAP is extendable, developers are free to add on custom authentication methods. EAP is commonly used for smart cards, certificates, and biometric devices such as fingerprint scanners. One of the more commonly used implementations of EAP is EAP-TLS. TLS stands for Transport Layer Security and is the next generation of SSL. It is commonly used for smart cards and certificates. If you see a question on the exam that mentions EAP-TLS, the answer is probably a smart card or certificate. If you are using wireless, you may come across WPA-EAP, otherwise known as WPA Enterprise. This authentication method passes requests on to a back-end server such as Radius. PEEP, or Protected EAP, provides the same functionality as EAP, however the communication is encapsulated using Transport Layer Security. In order to use PEEP, you must require certificates. PEEP does offer some additional features not supported by EAP. These include Fast Reconnect, often used with wireless. Fast Reconnect allows a wireless point to cache authentication information, meaning that when a user reconnects to a wireless point that they previously connected to, there will not be a delay waiting on the user to be re-authenticated. PEEP in Windows Server 2008 supports two authentication methods. The first is PEEP EAP-TLS and uses smart cards and certificates. The second PEEP EAP MSCHAP version 2, which is used with usernames and passwords. If you are using this authentication method, the authenticating server requires a certificate so the client can verify the server's identity. The client will use the server certificate to create a secure tunnel that MSCHAP will travel over. Now that you have an understanding of how authentication protocols work, let's have a look at how to configure the default authentication protocols used in your domain. To modify the default authentication system for your domain, go into your domain controller and open Group Policy Management from Administrative Tools under the Start menu. Those who have used Windows Server 2003 in the past may be familiar with the Domain Security Policy and Domain Controller Security Policy. These have been moved to Group Policy Management. If I now edit the default domain policy, I can expand down to Account Policies, which is located under Windows Settings, and then Security Settings. This contains all the Kerberos settings for my domain. If I were to create another group policy, these settings would exist in the other group policy. However, changing these settings would have no effect. Account settings can only be defined once in a domain and thus can only be changed in the default domain policy. You can see under Kerberos policy, there are some settings for Kerberos, but in most cases the default should be fine. If you need to change your default account security, for example, enable complex passwords, you will want to configure it from Account Policies. In order to change the default authentication for my domain, remember that clients are authenticated by domain controllers. So in order to change the authentication method, I need to change the domain controller's group policy. Once I have opened the domain controller's group policy, I need to expand down to the security settings again, but this time expanding to local policies and then security options. In security options, I need to find network security, LAN manager authentication level. Here you can define which authentication methods your domain controller will use. You can see the options range from using LM authentication, which is not recommended, to enabling everything, and finally only allowing NTLM version 2. Kerberos is not mentioned, but is enabled by default. The last setting is the most secure, and the setting you should use if your clients support it. Selecting this option means NTLM version 2 and Kerberos authentication will be the only authentication protocols used. Before setting this setting, you should check to make sure you don't have any clients that do not support these authentication methods. In summary, remember that Kerberos is a ticket-based system. Initial authentication takes the longest, but once the client has been authenticated, accessing additional network resources is quite fast. When Kerberos is not available, use NTLM version 2 when that is available. Kerberos requires a trust relationship and thus is not available for a computer not in the domain or a computer connected to an NTLM trust relationship. Remember that EAP is an authentication framework. This means it includes a lot of authentication methods that may not be available in Windows. Sometimes these can be added to Windows, however, for the exam, you are not required to know the ones that come with Windows. In particular, remember that EAP TLS is mainly used with smart cards. You may get a question in the exam relating to this. This section has been more theory-based than the other sections, but provides a good foundation for the videos to come.